Thank you everyone for joining us for this webinar, Snapshot Strategies with Multitrack Audio with Mihály András and Dávid Rikk. My name is Mallory Misnarsik and I'm the project manager here at Harman. Just a few things before we get started. Everyone on the call is muted to keep down noise levels during this webinar. However, there is a Q&A function where you can submit questions to the presenters and they'll try to answer as many as possible at the end. This webinar will also be recorded and a link will be made available a few days after this presentation. We do have a number of other webinars taking place over the next few months for audio, lighting, video, and control. We encourage you to take a look at the different webinars in our Learning Sessions workshop series on pro.harman.com, as well as visiting Harman Professional Training to see our many on-demand and certification courses that are available to you for free. And now I'd like to introduce you to Mihály and Dávid, the presenters for today's webinar. Mihály is a Budapest-based live sound engineer who has worked at major venues including Aquarium Club, A38, and Budapest Park. Dávid has been head of sound at Aquarium Club, Hungary's biggest indoor venue, for the past 6 years. He has also worked on every major Hungarian festival. And now I'll pass it over to you guys.
Thank you very much. Hello, everyone. This is Andrea and Dávid from Budapest Aquarium Club. Thank you for Harman for the opportunity. We're going to be doing a lesson for you about snapshot strategies with Multitrack on a Studer Vista one. So, first of all, I'm going to give you a short recap about what actually snapshots are from our previous lesson. So, you need that? All right, recap snapshots on Vista. So, what is a snapshot? A snapshot is basically a lot like a show file, a title, in terms of saving the actual state of the console, just like you made a photograph of the actual state. The main difference is that in snapshots, you have the possibility to filter out what you want to save or recall and what you want to isolate. This way, you can automate certain parts of your songs and your whole show. You can make a whole snapshot list for every song, and you can save those changes for each song in those snapshots. In this case, on this console, you can recall or isolate any parameter. So this means you can mess around with basically anything: your gain, your levels, your mutes, your bus sends, your effect sends, EQ, dynamics, parameters. Basically, you can pretty much mess around with any of these parameters. So, how do you make snapshots on Vista One? The easiest way, Dávid will right now show you the GC, so you can see the GC and what I'm doing as well. On the desk, you have a button called Make Snapshot. So, if I push Make Snapshot, this will create a snapshot for me. You can see it on the GC. It's called snapshot number one. And right now, I basically saved the current state of the desk into this snapshot. For example, now I have snapshot one. I will move around some faders. And now I will create another snapshot. This is snapshot two. And if I switch between these two, you could see the fader movement, because in snapshot one, my faders were in that position. In snapshot two, they're like this. So it's basically almost like a show file. I have these parameter changes saved. So some other ways to create snapshots. You have four snapshot buttons on your desk as well. If you hold the Make Snapshot button down and hit one of the buttons, these are called snap keys. So basically, now I created snap key one by holding Make Snapshot button down and pushing the key. If I hold Make Snapshot again and push snap key two, I create another snapshot. This is another way to create a snapshot. If you rather use the GC screen, then you can go directly to the menu as well. You have options to recall, undo, make, update, and to do certain things with your snapshots already done, or create another one. Okay, so much about creating and recalling. So now I'm going to talk about isolation. So the easiest way to isolate a channel on the desk is to push the ISO button above your faders. By pushing ISO, you will isolate your whole channel. This means all of the parameters on the channel, EQ, dynamics, sense, whatever. When you have this turned on the channel and you recall a snapshot, whatever is saved into that snapshot regarding the isolated channel, it will not apply to the channel. All right. You can isolate as well certain sections from your channel. So for example, if I go to this view, compressor limiter, or just my music view, the way to do this is you hold the ISO button down and then you select certain parameters on the Vistonic view by touching their knob. And you can see the isolate mark next to the certain parameter that you are changing. So this way you can, for example, select your compressor threshold, you can isolate it, and when you recall a snapshot, your compressor threshold will remain the same, even though if in the snapshot the threshold was already changed. Yeah, you can isolate certain sections of the console by pressing the edit filter button on your desk. So on the GC, you can see once I pushed edit filter, there is a menu popping up. And this way I can basically isolate my whole input output assign. I can isolate my buses. So this gives me basically a quick guide to isolate a whole group, let's say it so. Even though when the edit filter button is turned on, and you can see it's turned on because it's flashing, not flashing, but it's red, this gives me the option to isolate. It's like I pushed isolate button on every channel. So this way, if I touch these faders, you can see they're going isolated. And if I move it, then the whole channel is going isolated as well. I can isolate any parameter on the Vistonic view, and basically this gives me the option to do this what I just showed you. So I turn edit filter off now, and even though there is one more button above edit filter, it's got filter off. So when you push filter off, then these filters are off and you can save snapshots that way. So at the time when you are recalling a snapshot, there might be a filter active, leaving some console settings unchanged upon recall of any snapshot. So each console parameter can therefore be in one of the following states. There are three states that they can be in. One is isolate. Right now, this channel is isolated. I can see it here because I can see the yellow ISO sign. But if I hit edit filter, when nothing is isolated or the parameter or the channel isn't isolated, you just see a red empty box like this. I hit isolate, I can see it's isolated. If I move the fader, it's isolated again because I'm in edit mode. There is a third option, which is called trim. You have to allow this in your snapshot menu if you go to the automation option. To the automation options, there is one option in this menu, it's called enable trim mode. So if I turn this on, then I will be able to use trim mode. So I hit edit filter, and now for my first touch, this channel went to isolate. For the second touch, it shows that there is a red T above in the channel strip. This means that this channel is in trim mode. Trim mode is basically good for a fader movement. So anytime you will apply the snapshot which in you save that fader movement. For example, I'm in snap key 2 now. This is my snapshot. Right now, this is in trim mode. I go out of edit mode. I pull down 10 dBs from this channel. And I create another snapshot, snap key 3. All right, so right now I will go back to this position. I will recall, for example, snapshot 2. It's in this position. With snap key 3, it will go down 10 dBs. And when I recall snap two, it goes then goes back to the same position where it was in snapshot two. All right, I will just. Yeah, it's a relative way. This is David just telling me. So this is not the position. It's not going into minus 10 because I pushed the fader. I pulled the fader to minus 10. It is doing a minus 10 dB move. So if I would be in a different position, for example, I push the fader to plus 10, and I recall again this snapshot, which here this channel is in trim mode. Then it's oh damn! I made a snapshot. So once again, I recall snap key two. This is in trim mode. I go to zero. 10. I make a snapshot. This is snapshot for now. For some reason, it's not doing it. I will delete this snapshot and then create snap key 3. Okay, I go back to. I will recall snap 1. So now it's plus 10, and I made a minus 10 dB move. I'm recalling snap 3. And it's going down minus 10, so it's not jumping to minus 10 dB position. It's not saving the position. It's a relative thing. It's doing a 10 minus 10 dB move because it's just trimming this channel. Okay, I will turn trim off on this one, and I will turn trim mode off as well because it might drive David crazy. This will reset. Okay, so yeah, one interesting way is to create partial snapshot is to create a gang. So if you look at the GC, I will delete all these snapshots now because it might get me confused and you as well. Just a second. So there are options here at about what new snapshots should include. Right now I'm in no mask mode. So it will the snapshot basically would only include the channel parameters that aren't not masked. If there is another mode, if I go to gang mode, this will mean that if I do a multi-selection and I create one snapshot right now. So this is my basic state on snap key one. And I, for example, put minus 10 dBs down here. And I create another snapshot, snap key 2. So if I recall snap key 1, my faders will come back here. Snap key 2, like this. And these changes will only apply to my gang, because in the snapshot, only those changes are saved which happened to these channels what are in the gang. And this applies not only to fader movement. If I would have changed any other parameters, they would still apply to these channels selected. The new snapshot includes setting is set to no mask. Yeah, I talked about no mask. And there is one question we will ask Paul about this as well, because we couldn't figure out. It is also possible to set the partial snapshot to active snapshot filter, and this would actually create a partial snapshot out of the settings currently not masked out by a snapshot filter. Unfortunately, we couldn't figure it out what it exactly does or means, but hopefully Paul will have a couple of minutes to answer this question for us as well. So this was my recap on snapshots. I will delete these. And I will give the floor to David, who will talk to you about some multitrack stuff and what you can do with snapshots and multitrack. David.
Okay. Okay, hello everyone. So this is me from behind the screen. So I will talk about, guide you through a simple session of snapshots. Basically, what I will do is I will talk about the different kind of automations I tend to use when I'm working with a band, and we have the and I have the possibility and the time to learn the show and build up snapshots from song to song, or even from a song part to song part in a certain song, to make myself more focused and have more time on actual mixing. So I'll guide you through what I usually do, how I start to build up some safety guards, guidelines, which are useful if you're doing snapshots. And with a few songs from the band Fish, I work with, it's a Hungarian pop punk band. I will show you those changes actually happening on the desk with audio. So the first thing I'll start with is mute automations. So if you're doing a show, you might have channels that you don't use in throughout the whole show. So you might have a guest musician, a guest vocalist. You might have some of the band members playing a certain instrument in certain songs, but not throughout the whole set list. And by automating these channel mutes, you do obviously mute these channels to get rid of unneeded stage bleed throughout the show when the musician or the actual instrument is not played. But by automating these mutes, you get the chance not to forget turning them on and off, because they will do it by themselves automatically upon recalling the snapshot. And also, you won't have to mess around mute groups, switching layers. You just save the snapshot, and it happens all the time. It's not different from a certain mute group, but as you can program it from song to song, it makes you easier and faster to apply those changes. The second thing I like to use throughout the show is send automation, and it can come handy in two different situations. So one of them, as you can see on the presentation, is monitor mixing. Because let's say there's a situation when some of the band members or all of them need different levels throughout a song from different instruments. The lead vocalist needs more of himself during a really quiet song. The drummer needs more of his reverb on the in-ears on a certain song, just to get more into the mood of that song, whatever changes they might need. If you don't make snapshots on those level changes, the song comes, you see on the set list you have to apply these certain changes, and then you have to tweak them one by one, so the musicians are not probably comfy from the first moment. And you also have to mess around with these changes instead of actually caring with the musicians' reactions coming from on stage. So with the snapshot automation, you can actually do all these level changes with one press of a button. So it's instant, you don't have to mess around with those. The musicians feel comfier, and you also can focus more on what they actually want on stage, a part of these changes. Also, this can come handy if you're playing with FX sends, because from song to song you can automate how much are you sending a certain channel to a certain aux bus to an effects processor, depending on you wanting more reverb, for example, in a channel, because the mood of the actual song asks for it, or whatever reason can it be. And then this connects with the next part. I usually automate FX parameters and FX types. Because as I told you before, different songs will need different approach on the amount of effects you're using, the type of effect, and how you set up the parameters of those effects. And also, it can be really useful when you're limited in FX engine usage. So let's say you maxed out on your desk, you would need 5 or 6 FX engines, but the DSP you have left is only enough for 4 engines. Now, if you have certain FX that would work on the same channels but on different songs, you have the possibility to change your FX types. For example, in one of the songs you need a vocal plate, but in the others you would use a vocal hole, but you don't have an extra engine for that FX. You can change your parameter of FX type from song to song. In this way, managing to have the FX you want with a lower amount of FX engines you actually have. So this is really handy. And then the one thing I will talk about in terms of not really using it myself is the EQ dynamics and fader processing during a show. And there are multiple reasons for not to and for to use them. I will mainly talk about the not to part because, let's say, throughout the show, you mostly want your dynamics, your EQ setups, and your fader movements to be constant, but not only in a way that when you have your vocal channel set up, you have your vocal EQ'd out perfectly, but then if you're not isolating it, and you have to do all of the changes and again or copy into the next snapshots. Although if they are isolated, then halfway throughout the show when you recognize, oh damn, maybe the vocal came a bit boomy by the low end, you can tweak that out and have it applied throughout all your snapshots. Freeing you some time copying the setup into every other snapshots. This goes mostly for input channel, EQ, and dynamic application. For the fader movements, the biggest reason or the most important reason I don't like to automate my faders, except for certain times when I really need to do a fader movement on a second or third layer, which I can't reach because I have to focus on something else. A part of that, fader movements is something I want to do and I like to do by myself. Mix the show, because that way, if those are not automated, so whatever I do applies for the rest of the snapshots, that way I can really focus on the musicians, how they play, the mood they play, and how they interact. Because maybe removing a few dBs from another song on vocals could be useful done by a snapshot. But let's say day of the show, the singer is super hyped up and he sings everything like 10 dB louder, then you would have to apply it to all of the snapshots. Instead of this, you can mix the show and not relying on preset fader movements, which would probably ruin your dynamic mixing, what you're doing during the show. Insert automation is also something useful if you're using either your internal FX engine or some external processors throughout the show. The possibility to have them inserted or getting out of insert, or also to set the wet dry ratio, because as Andrew told you about his first webinar, there's a possibility on the desk to set the dry wet ratio on a channel insert. So basically this way you can use a compressor for do a full or parallel compression, and you can set that ratio from song to song depending on how you need it. And then also the safety automation comes a really, really handy. Let's say you're using a lot of inserts. Doesn't matter if those are analog inserts or it's a Wave server or a Universal Audio Live Rack. There might be situations when they just not working. They do an error, they reboot by default, or you know, anything could happen. In that case, you would lose most of your channel's input because the insert point is cut. So that's a major risk of messing up a show badly. For this case, when I have the opportunity to use, and I use a lot of inserts, I always make a safety snapshot. Basically, the safety snapshot contains nothing but automation of all the inserts turned off. So this way you have time to either apply, if you cannot manage to get the inserts working again, you can apply EQ, dynamics, and you know anything to fix your show, or you have the time for actually fixing those inserts and still have the show running. So basically two ways to save your show. Instead of panicking with no audio and no option for, you know, turning the inserts off one by one, that takes a long time, especially if you have a lot of channels. And also, some useful thing could be, I don't use it that much, but the automation crossfade basically can, with the theater cue list engaged and engaging the crossfade option on your GC, you have the possibility to set up crossfade times between the different snapshots. So you can set the time how fast or how slow you want those changes to apply upon recalling the next snapshot. So what I will do now is I built my basic snapshot. And then we get moving on. So first I'm going to go, with my control bay, because this is a useful safety guideline I forgot when I started to do snapshots by myself and messed up stuff. So what I like to do is keep my VCAs, my master channel, and basically all of my masters for like my auxes and my groups, which are basically output masters, fully isolated, because those are the channels I want to keep constant. If I want to mix them, if I want to change them, and obviously I will, because I'm mixing a live show, but if I do any kind of changes on them, I want to apply for the whole session. And I don't want to, for example, by mistake, mute one or more groups or for my master, save it, update on my snapshot, and then upon recall, lose certain channels or my whole show. So what I do is my output routing and my output channels are fully isolated all the times, just to keep me safe. Then I go to my input channels and I start by, actually, let me make a gang. And I isolate them all fully. So right now, nothing is stored and nothing is recalled upon recalling a snapshot. Now, the next what I will do is I set up the basic parameters I want to save upon, or I want to recall upon a snapshot recall. So I go to my graphic controller buttons and I activate my filter mode. As Andrew showed you before, so right now all of my parameters are in edit filter mode, so whatever I touch, whatever button I push, it will leave isolation, since right now it's isolated. So I know for sure that with this band I have my lead singer playing guitar. Whoops, gang again, sorry. Okay. So, but he doesn't play it in every song. So I unisolate my mute channel. The rest of the band is playing throughout the show, so the rest I will leave that way. Then I go to my FX returns. I know I will change those from time to time. So first I press the faders so I can automate their levels. Then I press the mutes because I will play around with mutes. And I will also change FX parameters or types. So I engage into the FX engines. You can do it by pressing at the lower part, you have this little lexicon window. By pressing it, you can enter the different FX engines parameters and types to check it out what's actually happening. And as you can see right now, none of them is yellowed out. So they are in safe mode. They are not in safe mode, sorry for the mistake. So I leave it right there because I want to change those parameters throughout the show. And I also want to automate some of my effects but only the sends. Everything is turned on. I only automate the sends. So I push the encoders of my room and my plate reverb throughout my drum channels because I will apply changes to those for sure. And then I go to my second layer, which contains my vocal effects. And for my background vocalists, my lead vocals, I will turn on snapshot mode for those sends and the delay for my lead singer. And as far as I remember, this is what we will apply. So right now I will get out of edit filter mode by pressing edit filter down at the graphical controller button layout. This is basically a layout to reach certain sections or do certain movements, what you would do on the GC with your mouse, but this makes it faster. So I've quit edit filter mode, and now by pressing make snapshot, I made my first snapshot. This is my basic snapshot, which I will use for the first song. So in advance, I'll tell you that the first song starts and keeps the intro with an airy, funk, reggae kind of vibe throughout the chorus as well. So I will build up the reverbs for that, and also this is how it goes down. So first I mute my guitar channel, which I'm not using. Then I'm checking out my plate reverbs on the snare and the toms. I will boost them on my FX send. And I also apply a nice amount of room for this first song you will hear shortly. And then I also apply there's plenty of delay and whole send to the vocals, so I can leave them that way. And I will also mute and lower my fader for the delay. I'm not using delay for the first song. It's just for me to make it super safe, not to engage any delay. Mm-hmm. By setting up next for this song, I will create a bigger room. More spready, less high-end. Then I'll change my drum plate to make it a nice long plate on the snare. For this song, not too much high-end audio. And then also for the vocal, I will use a vocal hole. Mid-sized. Lots of pre-delay so it not messes up my speech intelligibility. I cannot say that word, sorry. Okay, so right now what I will do is go to my GC and I will update my snapshot. Audio plus mask, yep. And then I will ask Andrew to start the first song, and then actually what I will do is I just show you that the reverbs are actually happening on the drums. And on the vocals, and then I build up the sends and the effects and the effects returns for the second song, and then we check out the crossfade the switch from one snapshot to the other.
Múzsa, szavakkal lesz tele a szám. Ha másnap látszik még a rúzsa, akkor jó csak, igazán nincs személyes.
And also I realized that my vocals are a bit boomy by the low end. So I select my vocal channel and change the EQ at the low end a lot. So this way, although I changed something, I don't have to copy it. Like right now I have only this snapshot, but since the EQ is isolated, this EQ applies to the rest of the snapshots I already have and the ones I'm making after this one. So after that I don't have to mess around with applying again and again the EQ for that channel.
Nemzeti hip-hopot! Magyar nemzeti hip-hopot! Magyar nemzeti hip-hopot! Magyar nemzeti hip-hopot! Magyar nemzeti hip-hopot! Nincs személyes üzenetem, nem kérdeztek, vagy nem jól emlékszem, ha csak a felét érti, az elég nekem, de nincs személyes üzenetem!
Okay, so I finalized the aux sends, the effects. So right now I will update, and then I will go ask Andrew to start the second song. I can listen to it, and then I'll make a new snapshot. So I just made my second snapshot, and we will listen to the second song and do changes that fits that song.
Lentről mégis felkelek, és jól érzem magam, vagy legalábbis azt mondom magamnak, hogy minden rendben van. Kimegyek a rétre, ki a térre, vagy átúszom a folyót, felhívlak téged, hát ha te érzed, csináljunk valami jót! Táska vár a cipő a lábra, sétáljunk a hídon át, a közepén állj meg! Hey, állj meg!
Okay, so I think this song doesn't need at all that much of room and plate, so make it less reverberated, but I want to change. I could do it by applying a fader movement to my reverb returns, but actually I want some of my channels have different amounts, so I will keep my faders up for now. And firstly, just get off my room reverbs, about, let's say, let's go 10-12 dBs, make it a lot. And also my plate just a little lower, so it can cut through more. It's not, this song is not that airy. And then, for my FX, I will also switch the room to a less verberant one. Change my plate to a smaller one with shorter decay, a bit more high end, and also change my vocal to a plate, reducing it a lot just to have a hint of it. Roll out a little bit the high ends, and now that's it. I'll update it, and then I'll ask Andrew to dial back to the change between song number one and number two, and I will show you first just with the drums how the reverbs actually change throughout the snapshot changing. And I won't update it because that would mess up everything. Okay. Just a sec. Okay. As you could hear, all my reverbs changed, got it shorter, got it punchier. So I will show you this once again, just the change with the whole band playing.
Lentről mégis felkelek, és jól érzem magam, vagy legalábbis azt mondom magamnak, hogy minden rendben van. Kimegyek a rétre, ki a térre, vagy átúszom a folyót, felhívlak téged, hát ha te érzed. Csináljunk valami jót, táska vár a cipő, a lábra sétáljunk a hídon át, a közepén állj meg!
I made a slight adjustment by adding more to my plate reverb send of the snare. So right now I update everything. So this part is done, and then I will do a third snapshot by just showing you actually the mute automation, some fader automation happening for my last song. So I make a third snapshot. For this one I will leave, because it's a pretty much similar, a bit faster song, the reverbs that way, but I have to engage the guitar for my guitarist. Also engage my delay, unmute it, and tap it is as well, so I don't have to mess around with that. It's a pretty fast slapback delay. Little slower, yeah, around that. So right now I will update that one, and then let's see if it's happening. Yeah, I didn't mute this one. I update that one, audio mask, yep. So upon recalling my third snapshot, you can see my guitar channel unmutes itself, and in the same time my delay channel goes up, delay return goes up to zero, unmutes itself, and also have my tap time engaged. So let's just check that movement. With the music itself, and I'll try, I won't say I will make it work, to apply a crossfade for my guitar. So let's say the starting point is here. And then I recall that snapshot. Oh, it wasn't isolated, sorry. So first of all, I will go to edit filter mode, unisolate this one, update, then go to my next snapshot where I have this fader all the way up, and then I enter cue list at the graphical controller. I dial in those two and I activate the X fade and arm my cue list, lower the crossfade times. Actually, I'm not sure if it's doing switch after crossfade. Okay. So, switch during crossfade. That's for me. I will update those snapshots. Then it gets a little tricky to make it working. So I have this, I have this, I have this, and it's a little too slow. Go back to my cue list and I lower my values. Let's say it's a 5-second-ish. And then I'll update those. Snapshot 2, I update snapshot 3. Get out the snapshots. Getting into snapshot 2. And then oh, come on. Okay, I made a mistake somewhere, which I'm not sure. Too bad for me. Yeah, I know, where's the mistake? So the mistake is I have to update this position. And then hopefully this time. Yep. As you can see, my fader is slowly going up as I'm switching the snapshot. So if we ask Andrew to start the song, I will engage my cue. And then when it finishes, it will do the whole change. Now, as you can see, after it finished the cue change, the crossfade, it switched automatically to snapshot 3. And I think that's all I wanted to say. And hopefully we have some time. So hopefully we have some time for Q&A with the help of Paul. And thank you all for joining in and listening to this little webinar.
My apologies, it seems better if I unmute myself and I can actually be heard then. So there was a couple of questions that came in. One of the first ones was, so there was a question about what the gang function meant. Is it group? It's basically the ability to group channel strips together and have them all activated under the snapshot recall or save at the same time. So that's what the gang function does there. There's another one that's just come in. about the edit global filter, which is the same filter across all snapshots. Yes, so the difference between the two is actually relatively simple. Global filters enables you to put in place a filter or an isolation of any of the strips and the controls on any of the strips. And that will be active at any time. So if you set it with the global filter, any recalls on a snapshot will basically ignore that function's ability to be recalled. That also comes in where the active under the snapshot window where it says new snapshots include active snapshot filter. You can actually create a global filter there. And then when you then save the snapshot, all of the filters that are associated with the global setting will be carried into the new snapshot. And then normally what happens is you turn the global filter off and then the snapshot recall will only recall the ones that you require to come back that are outside of that original filter. I have another question just come in. Recommended number of maximum snapshots on a live show. The reality is that the console basically says that it's infinite. There is no upper limit. What we found from a real perspective is that you're probably in the 500 to 900 range, depending on how much filtering you're doing and how many snapshots you're actually creating. Obviously, the more filtering and isolation you're doing between snapshots will effectively take up more memory within the system. But in general, I've seen shows that are close to 1,000 snapshots and have not been any problem. that's actually quite common for sort of some of the large theatrical performing arts type consoles. They're often in the hundreds, many hundreds. So, I think that's all the questions I have come through.
Perfect. I just want to close out by thanking David and Mihály for this session, and thank you everyone that has joined us. I hope you have a great rest of your day.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. Bye.
Bye, everyone. Bye.